course on career counseling, it is extremely important to understand why you should take your career choice seriously. In this video, we will help you understand the importance of making the right career choice for yourself. So, why is your career choice so important? It is important because it determines a lot of things in your life, including number 1, quality of life. Your career choice plays a huge role in deciding where you live, how flexible your life is, and the kinds of things you are able to do in your free time. Number 2, identity. Ask any elder person about their career and they will tell you about it as a part of their identity. They'll say something like, "I am a journalist," instead of, "I report news." Notice how everybody asks you, "What do you want to be when you grow up?" and not, "What do you want to do when you grow up?" This shows that your career choice shapes your identity. Number 3, impact. Every human life touches thousands of other lives in so many different ways. If you select any 60-year-old person who is about to retire, take a time machine, find him as an infant, throw that infant into trash, and then come back to the present day, you'll find that a countless number of things around you have changed. So whatever career you choose, the world will be affected by it. Anything that determines your quality of life, your identity, and the impact that you make should be taken very seriously. And that includes your career choice also. So we hope that this short video could help you understand the importance of making the right career choice. Having done that, we will now move forward to start our career counseling course. We are pretty excited and we hope you are too. So, let's begin. See you.
Hello everyone, good evening. Welcome to day 65 of ProBono's live podcast. We are back to the discussion that we usually have once a week. That is, we talk about a topic, a very important topic in fact, not just in anyone's career, but also in anyone's life in general. So firstly, I want to welcome Mr. Sen, of course, as usual, Aditya and Pragya running the stream. So firstly, and also welcome to all the audience members. और प्लीज डू बी इंटरैक्टिव इन चैट. आई थिंक आज का डिस्कशन बहुत ही अच्छा होने वाला है एंड वी एब्सोल्युटली वुड वांट टू हियर ऑल ऑफ योर ओपिनियंस ऑन द टॉपिक वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस. सो आज का जो टॉपिक दैट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस इज वील ट्राई टू, आई एम नॉट सेइंग वी विल, बट वील एब्सोल्युटली ट्राई टू डिस्कवर द मिस्टीरियस एंड द अनचार्टेड डोमेन कॉल्ड टाइम. बहुत ही लाइक देयर यू गो, आई हैव यूज्ड मल्टीपल भारी भारी शब्द यूज कर लिया है, मेरा टंकी खाली हो गया. नाउ आई वांट मिस्टर सेन टू इंट्रोड्यूस अस टू द टॉपिक. मिस्टर सेन,
गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, थैंक यू सो मच. दैट वाज अ वेरी फास्ट हैंडओवर. यू ब्रोक द वर्ल्ड रिकॉर्ड हैंडिंग इट ओवर. Anyway, I think that also proves that why time is mysterious and why it is uncharted. Yeah, I mean, it is mysterious because we don't understand time. And frankly, we do not know what to do with time. For some people at some times, there's a lot of time. And for the same people at other times, there is no time. Having said that, time is constant. We still have just 24 hours in a day. We have 60 minutes to the hour and 60 seconds to the minute, and it doesn't change. So why is it mysterious and why is it that we don't seem to understand it fully? I think that's something that we're going to sort of try and discover today. And in the meantime, let's ask the audience, what do they think about the mystery of time and why is it so uncharted? So before we get into it, let's have an opening statement from Aditya as well. So Aditya.
Hello, good evening. And thank you so much everyone in the audience for being a regular visitor. And thank you so much to Mr. Sen and Samant for making the opening statements. I think I'm back here after two long days, and I was there in the audience. So I had to miss like the first 5-10 minutes of the podcast because of which I missed the whole hosting experience, and I was there in the audience for both of them. So it was really good experience as an audience member also to view these podcasts. I think after 60 odd podcasts, I was the first time an audience member in these. So it was amazing. And regarding time, so and there are like varying opinions everywhere. So I personally have felt in my life when till the time I was a college student, time was available in abundance. And when I say abundance, it was there, you know, a lot. So I had a lot of time in my hands. I used to be the kid in school who used to play outdoors, who used to play FIFA and other games on computer, who used to watch all the TV shows you can imagine, cartoons, reality shows, MTV, you know, hear all the latest songs, and watching cricket, football, everything I used to watch. And after that, I was like, I had enough time to study that I used to score decent percentage in school also. So I thought that I'm a great time manager when I was a kid. Then I grew up to be a college student. Again, pretty easy to manage time there, according to me. You had to attend classes 8 to 5. Then I was also managing time in my startup. I had just started to think of starting my own startup. So I was just starting to make my website, a few videos here and there. And you can view them on our YouTube channel. They're still live. The videos that I made in college. After that, I got into the startup full time. That is when I started realizing I'm not that good a time manager after all. Just one startup has taken up a lot of my time. And I don't regret it. At the same time, I do find sometimes that time is less according to the activities that I want to do in that time. So my feelings about time have changed a lot. My idea of leisure has changed a lot. So, you know, earlier I wanted at least 16 hours of leisure in a day. Now I would be very happy if I get like an hour of leisure, like, you know, an hour of just relaxing. So all these things have changed a lot. And I think that is what we discussed today. We had discussed time management a bit earlier in this podcast also. But today we discussed the mystery of time. So where to give your time? What is a good work-life balance? Is there a good work-life balance? Do you need to work always? Do you always need to do something productive? What time do you need to relax for? All these questions, please contribute your thoughts, and I think we'll contribute ours. Over to Samant.
So firstly, I want to put this, you know, make this clear and maybe get both of your perspective and the audience as well. So college mein, obviously now I'm better at managing time, or at least I'm getting things done quickly. I won't say I'm managing time better, but I'm getting things done based on the deadline that a person has given me, mostly Aditya only. College mein, now we used to make reports, assignments for the, you know, at the end of the semester, vivas and everything. So we had to make reports that were anywhere between 20 to 30 pages to 200 to 300 pages. At least that was a requirement. I can neither confirm nor deny that. Have I fulfilled that particular requirements? I won't answer that. But the thing is, I won't be, you know, even touching the report, or at least getting close to starting the report for the first 90 days of the 90% of the time allotted to me. And maybe 1 or 2 days before, all the reports would be completed, albeit they were not up to the requirement that I would receive a 10 out of 10, but then they would be completed. So would you say I'm good at time, managing time, or I just waste time and aakhri mein dar aake kar deta? So what do you guys think?
So you gave an example of an outcome that, or an output, let's put it that way, output that has to be finished within a certain time, and it had a certain quantity that had to be produced. And what was in that production really didn't matter, as long as the quantity was met and the time was met. So I think that actually neatly sums up the way we actually measure output anywhere and everywhere. People churn out reports and reports and reports, staying awake at night, And finally, no one reads them beyond the first page, perhaps, if they're lucky. So of the 200 pages that you wrote, Samant, you would be lucky if somebody has read more than page one. But that's the way it is.
What used to happen, Mr. Sen, when I walk into the Viva room, obviously the person who would be taking the Viva would be an external person. It can't be anyone from within the university. So obviously what they're going to do is basically, you know, now again, this could be throwing shade at that person. I'm not going to take names. But then it would just be like, okay, here's open the report. How's handwriting? Okay, there's a random page that popped up that contains a little bit of theory. Okay, I'm going to ask this person the three questions that I've already written in the report. So that used to be, and maybe 4 to 5 out of 10 Vivas, I'm giving an example, 40 to 50% of the examiners that took my Viva used to actually ask me what I had done on the field. You know, what was your experience? What did you learn? You know, if this was the case or this was a scenario, what would you do? Where it actually makes you think, not just, you know, okay, what is the definition of XYZ terminology? Or rather, in 3 years, what is the meaning of Farani trait or pre-radulization? That wasn't the case, you know? So,
yeah, so that brings me to a very interesting thought triggered by Samant and by Aditya. Is time is limited. So we all have a lifespan of X number of years. So it could be anything between 70 to 80 to 90 to 100, whatever the case may be. And it's limited. You cannot go beyond that. So when we are born with an expiry date stamped on us. That's your expiry date. Now it's up to us to make the best use of that time. And I think therein lies the problem. The first, 20 years, 18 to 20 years is gone in running after results and, you know, marks and grades, whether it be in class one or the first year or the final year of your studies. And we are running after that mark. We have devoted 1/3 or maybe more of our lives to doing that. The lucky few, and this is where the career comes in, and I'm going to pull in Aditya over here. So the lucky few who do not run after marks, and I think somebody asked the other day, how do we not be part of the rat race? I think it was Anita Ji, if I remember right, in one of the podcasts. And I said, it's a choice that you have. You make a choice. So I think with time, we all need to make a choice of how we want to spend it. Money we can earn. And earn and earn and spend. But time we cannot earn. I think that's where the whole difference is. So what do you think, Aditya, about time and its influence on the career that one has to do?
And there's a comment by Anita Ji as well who says, Samay kabhi wapas nahi aata.
Haan, sahi baat hai, samay kabhi wapas nahi aata. Aur isiliye aap jab sochte ho hindsight mein ki पहले मैंने क्या किया, मैं इसको कैसे बेहतर कर सकता था, आप सोचकर आगे के समय पे वो अप्लाई कर सकते हो, लेकिन पुराने समय के बारे में कुछ भी बदल नहीं सकते. एंड अबाउट टाइम, दे से अनदर थिंग दैट टाइम इज अ ग्रेट हीलर. आई हैव पर्सनली सीन दिस इन अ लॉट ऑफ ओकेजंस, लाइक माय पर्सनल एक्सपीरियंसेस. दुख हुई, बहुत दुख हुआ रादर इन किसी चीजों को लेकर, और मैं सामान जैसा बनता है, दुख हुई या दुख हुआ, आई एम कंफ्यूज नाउ. सो मेरे को दुख हुआ बहुत सारी चीजों का, लेकिन धीरे धीरे जब वक्त बीतता है तो वो दुख अपने आप कम होता जाता है, आप दूसरे दूसरे चीजों में इन्वॉल्व होते जाते हो. सो नाउ एड्रेसिंग मिस्टर सेन्स क्वेश्चन, एंड आई एम रियली ग्लैड दैट मिस्टर सेन इज आस्किंग मी क्वेश्चंस. वाओ. सो रिगार्डिंग टाइम एंड हाउ टू यूज इट इन वन्स करियर, आई हैव अ फिलोसफी विच अगेन ऑडियंस कैन डिसाइड टू अग्री और डिसएग्री विद. डू लेट अस नो इन द कमेंट सेक्शन, हाउ डू यू यूज योर टाइम इन योर करियर. And how important is your time in your career? I believe it is the most important resource that you have. That is the only thing which everyone has in equal capacity and in equal amount, right? So you might be born poor, you might be born rich, you might be born, you know, in an area which does not have a lot of opportunities, you might be born in a very good city with a lot of access to resources. Everything you are born with has some or the other level of, you know, this to it, like, you know, equality, inequality to it. But time is the only resource that everyone has equal access to. Now, whatever level, you know, whatever playing field you're starting with, it might not be level, but at least if you start off at your place, at any place, through the use of time, you can progress. And why to progress? That's another question. Why do we even decide to progress? Shouldn't I just enjoy life? Now, here's where my principle comes in. I personally believe that enjoyment, if it is to be enjoyed in the long term, if life is to be enjoyed in the long term, it needs to have a purpose. And this might sound very spiritual to you, but I assure you, I'm not a very spiritual person in thinking. I'm more objective towards, you know, reality. Now, many people might think of spirituality as objective to reality. That's your choice to make. But I personally believe that if your life has to be one that is to be enjoyed, then you should have a purpose. Because if you are just, you know, relaxing, after a point in time, your relaxation will yield you no enjoyment because you will get bored of it. So ever notice this fact that whenever you're working a lot, whenever you're working very hard, after that, if you get a holiday after like 40, 50 days, the harder you work for a specific amount of time and you get a holiday, even if it is a small one, you enjoy it a lot more than you would have if you would have gotten a 20 holidays in a stretch. There's a reason behind that, because, you know, whatever you get lesser, you value more. So if you get a lot of relaxation in your life, you'll not value it anymore. So it needs to be a balance. Purpose gives you that balance, because when you have purpose in life, then you're working towards something which is solving a problem, which is something that is advancing humanity. In your small way, in a big way, you decide. But when you're working towards it, firstly, you don't realize how time passes away. So you're enjoying your work and whatever little time of relaxation you get. Second, when you're relaxing, you're enjoying it much more because now that is exclusive. Third, through your time, you are helping humanity advance, which can be the greatest use of time. That is why I personally believe that a larger part of your day should definitely be work. But yes, and this is me giving you this advice who personally does not follow this. But yeah, if you can, it would be great for you. That do find a good balance. I personally do struggle to find that balance a lot. I sometimes work too much in a day. But yeah, I have relaxed enough in my, you know, 3 years ago in my life. I think that's why it's getting compensated a bit. So I've relaxed enough, but yeah, it's good to keep the machine oiled. And I think that relaxation time is your petrol in a way, if you're a car, if you, you know, give that analogy. So that is your fuel to keep driving that purpose in your life. So if you are relaxing less, if you are resting less, if you are eating food, not eating food, basically. So all these things will ultimately affect the amount you can contribute to the society. So if you want to contribute also to the society, it should be a good balance between relaxation and work. But then what is that balance and what balance are you happy with? That is the decision that you take for yourself. And obviously then there is a biological cycle. So that's my take on it, Mr. Singh.
That's very interesting.
Aditya, what you said was the title, if I were to term it, maybe you didn't know the term, was delayed gratification. Working for 50 straight days and getting a break and enjoying the break is delayed gratification. That's the term.
That's a very interesting way of looking at it. With time, I think there is another associated term, which is perspective. Because the two of them are together. So we look at things in a certain way, at a certain time, based on our own perspective. When we look at the same thing at a different time, it looks different. So like in Aditya's example, so when you're working hard, and you're working hard at the age of 20, 24, 25, you feel happy about it, time goes by, but you're working hard again at the age of 35, and you have a family then, and you're trying to grow the family, then, you know, that working hard, the perspective becomes a bit different. So time and perspective go together, and I think all of you will go through the whole thing again. And that brings me to a very different sort of a question that I want to ask the two of you.
Now, yes. Mr. Sin, before you actually get to the question, I want to comment on what you said, you know, different perspectives. So I think what you said about, you know, at one point in time, you look at item A, basically, let me just, you know, as a reference, you look at item A in a certain perspective, maybe in a positive way, let's just say, forever, whatever. For the sake of the argument.
Whatever.
And in another point in time, you look at it, I think it mostly has to deal with, one, your feelings, of course, you know, fear. Feelings and emotions at that point in life. If you're a teenager, you're more impulsive and, you know, you're very irrational. And then if you are maybe, say, 50-year-old, that's, you know, or maybe 40-year-old, that's, you know, kind of getting to a point where you're not young to experiment. You're not too old to retire. You're there in between. You're just getting things done. Or maybe I'm guessing. You could correct me if I'm wrong.
Thank God you didn't say when you reach the age of 50, you're more matured.
No, I think when you reach the age of 50, there's a sense of urgency, and every person, you try to create a legacy to leave behind for your family or your kids or anyone that is associated with you. There's an urgency to create a legacy, I feel.
That's very.
That's an opinion. That's not a fact. So do feel free to, you know, oppose me. That's.
No, that's absolutely clear. And so now, I mean, so Aditya mentioned that when he was in school and college, and, you know, the earlier days of his life, his perspective of time was, you know, oh, it's time to play games, watch movies, watch TV shows, listen to music, and so on and so forth. Now, further down the timeline, when he's there now, his perspective is somewhat different. He talked about it. He said that now I look at time that we need to work hard to do something, get things in place and all of that thing. So that's the perspective I'm talking about. So now that playing a game or watching the TV or listening to a song is not that important as what it used to be earlier. That's, I think, a perspective. That's how we look at things. And I think time is something that does many things to our perspective. And the way we see it is the way time behaves, actually. So time behaves the way, this is my thing, time behaves the way you want it to behave. So a corollary of that would be you can actually train time. You know, like you can train a dog, that the dog will start behaving the way you want it to behave. You can actually do that with time. Aditya, what do you think?
Absolutely. I think I totally agree with this. And this is, I think, something which we should take away as an insight from this podcast. Because, see, sometimes what would happen is we have these amazing discussions. But we also do need to remember that there is something to take away from these conversations. And I always look at it from that angle. That if I've learned something, I'll remember it, I'll try to apply it. So whoever is watching this, I would just urge you to, you know, this is my learning. I'm not forcing you to exactly draw away this from the podcast, and that's why it's a very free format. You can draw away whatever you want to, but do make sure that whatever you learn from, at least try to apply it to see whether it is even valid or not. Because I think, you know, we were mentioning Swami Vivekananda in one of the podcasts where we were discussing idols again with our team. And our interns. So somebody mentioned Swami Vivekananda. He used to say one thing which I have fallen in love with from childhood, that don't worship the known, question it. I think he said a different form of it. I just paraphrased it. But that's what he said basically, that it's not necessary that what is being said because of the societal wisdom might always be correct. So to question whatever we are saying, you need to apply it, right? So let's say Mr. Sain said this, and I personally found it amazing that time behaves the way you want it to. So I'll apply it, and if it does not work, then I'll again probably ask Mr. Sain, why doesn't it work? Is it a problem in my application, or is it the problem in the theory, right? And if it works, great, I learned something new.
Okay,
so that's my way of looking at things.
The answer to that, Aditya, is quite simple, and I talked about this in one of the podcasts. The purpose we know, I mean, the purpose is fine. Everybody has a purpose or whatever it may be. What you do is your career, your, you know, the rest of the things that you do. But how you train time is how you live your life. And I remember I talked about, you know, I referred that TED talk of Shannon Lee of, you know, the how. So it's a question of how you deal with time. That will be defining Aditya as a person, Samant as a person, and the rest of the people as a person, Pragya as a person. So it's the how. So what do we choose to do with time? How do we choose to spend it? And the choice is ours. We can do anything with the choice. And how do we choose to spend it will define us as a human being. It'll not be what I did. It'll also not be why I did it. But it'll always be how I did it. I'll give an example. How I treat people. Do I treat them civilly? With civil, you know, being civil with them? Or do I treat them incivilly, which is not being civil with them? Do I treat them with kindness and love? Do I treat them harshly, like a tyrant? That defines me as a person. And it's a choice that I can make. How I want to spend time, how I want to live. And let me just go around quickly to Samant and Aditya yourself. And after that, I'll tell you a little bit of story. So let's do that. Samant, what do you think about what I said?
I think what you do with time. You know, there was actually a quote from, it doesn't have to do with time. There's a quote from the video game God of War 3 back in 2010, if I remember correctly. The quote said, "The measure of a man is what he does with his power." Now, for now, we'll paraphrase that. We'll say, the measure of a man is what he does with his time.
It's not what, it's how. The what he does with time is very simple. He builds a career, he builds a castle, he becomes a billionaire, becomes the richest man in the world. That's what he does. But how does he spend the time? How does he live the time? That's the difference I was trying to make. And that is the defining purpose.
Right.
That's a bit different. No problem. Aditya,
right.
Think about it.
Yeah.
So I've also put in the comment section, Mr. Sain's comment on time. Time behaves the way you want it to. I think that's something to learn. But again, it's your choice. So my perspective, and Mr. Sain also talked about perspective. I again would agree to that. Because time is all about perspective. Now see, I have this perspective where you work with a purpose. You use your time with a purpose. And everything then rotates around that purpose. So even if you're relaxing, that is ultimately, like in the longer run, obviously, when you're relaxing, you don't think, "Achha, mere andar fuel bhar raha hai, main kal aur kaam karunga, uske liye main relax." No, that's not how you think. But ultimately, it's that. Like the main use of time is for a purpose. And when you're relaxing, ultimately, you're fueling yourself to be able to work again, use that time again for that purpose. That's my way of looking at it. So that's my perspective. And it depends what perspective you bring to time. So my perspective in these times I would like to talk about and then ask Mr. Sain's and Saman's perspective. So I was hearing a lot these days, you know, people post their opinions on social media, which is a great way to learn from people what they think, you know, and it's always great to learn from people who maybe aren't experts in the industry yet, but then have some amazing thoughts on certain topics. So it's not necessary because we used to hear this thing that always take advice from someone whom you would want to trade places with. But eventually I also went on to believe that advice can be taken from anyone. Maybe someone who is not an expert in his or her industry is good with certain topics on which maybe he or she can teach you something. So I do watch these opinions posted on social media a lot. And one school of thought on social media, especially with relation to these webinars or with relation to these you know, productivity contests literally that are going on, that okay, if you're at home and if you have time, you have to do something productive. So you either have to cook, or you have to do house chores, or you have to do these webinars, or, you know, make productive use of your time. You cannot rest. So people think that it is a propaganda to host a productive contest, a productivity contest rather. And my thought on that is that even if it is a productivity contest, I won't say that it should be. I definitely do feel that the purpose should always hold the bigger, you know, importance. While at the same time, if you're working towards a purpose, now is the best time to do it. So why wouldn't I advise you to relax a lot? And that is, again, my opinion, is because, so let's say, you know, to just to give an analogy, that you are on a ship. That ship is in the middle of a sea. And suddenly, while it is in the middle of a sea, there's a huge thunderstorm. Now, will you think that I've been working for the past 2 months, man, I'm too tired to deal with the storm, I'll just take a rest? Will you think that? Or will you think that let me work hard for these 2-3 days, make sure that this ship survives, right? If you are in charge of the ship, that make sure that this ship survives in this time, and then probably I'll take some rest. So probably you'll do the second thing, because at that time, if you don't survive, there is no work-life balance anymore. Then either if you believe in the concept of rebirth, then you're reborn. And if you don't, then your life ends right there. So according to me, at that time, you won't really worry about work-life balance, right? And that is my thinking in this time. So that thunderstorm, which I was talking about in the middle of the sea, is the current time, which the whole of humanity is facing. I live in an urban area, and I still... And it has been 2 months since the lockdown has started, more than 2 months. We ourselves have hosted more than 60 podcasts now, and our podcast started right one day before the lockdown. So this is a good way also to keep track how many days have gone on since the lockdown. So I was seeing outside my house, just outside my house, there's a road. And still the laborers are being, you know, the laborers are traveling back to their home states, to their home villages. Still, it's been 60 days. That is the plight. So we are still working hard. Everyone in, you know, in humanity is working hard to survive in our own way. Some people are rich, so they are trying to probably, you know, maintain their lifestyle. They are probably trying to, because if they are rich, obviously they would be doing something of high value. So they are trying to maintain that work should keep going on, that economy should keep driving itself. People who barely have funds are trying to at least replenish those funds which they have lost. And everyone is working to survive. So at this time, rather not think about work-life balance, according to me, because these are tough times. And at this time, if you do want to survive, so definitely it's a very good time to work on your purpose. That is my perspective on time and time right now. What do you think about this, Mr. Sen and Samant?
Samant, go first.
Firstly, I want to read a comment from Anita ji. There are multiple comments, but I'll read this one. It's more specific to, I think, the part where Aditya mentioned the need for purpose. So Anita ji says, maximum utilization of time can be done by doing things purposefully in each and every moment of life, along with creating good memories.
That's great.
Question repeat kar sakte ho, in short. That was sure. A long rant. I couldn't point out where the question was.
Hey, don't underestimate by saying it is a rant. It's my it's my humble opinion, man. But yeah, if I were to, like, you know, paraphrase this question in a shorter sentence, I was asking, what is your perspective towards time right now? Do you really think it is important for us to figure out work-life balance, or do you think it is important for us to work very hard to survive? And my opinion is that we need to work very hard to survive, but it's now your take on this. What do you think?
So firstly, one thing I would say is there's always been this predetermined structure of life, you know, like, okay, between this age and this age, you'll have to do this. At this age, you need to get married. This age, you need to get into a management position. This age, you need to, I don't know, you need to get your kids to get married. You know, your children have to get married. By 60 or 62, you have to retire. And then after 60, you have to get into an old age home and whatnot. So I think that we already have a predetermined a structure of life where, you know, I don't know who created this. Obviously, it's a norm of life based on the general consensus. But I think firstly, that needs to break in, you know, that a certain thing has to be done within the certain age limit. Obviously, if you're talking about a few things related to biology, I think, yes, it has to be done before a certain age because the body falls apart. That I agree with. That includes sports, having children, and so on and so forth, where you have no control over your body. But your mind, you absolutely have control until a point where, you know, because of old age, you can have dementia, and so we're not getting into that. But I think you have a good amount of time between the ages of 20 to, let's say, 65. You have 45 years of time. And I think that 45 years of time, history has proven that things can be done. Extraordinary things can be done that we remembered for the rest of, for the rest of our existence as a species. And how did they come about? How did that those people come to achieving that? Again, goes back to, I'm probably ripping off your own your comment, but I think it's a sense of purpose. And more importantly, if you look at it from an individual selfish point of view, it goes back to creating a legacy. How will people remember me when I die? I think that's a small selfish reason, or maybe I need to earn money, or I need to leave a legacy behind where people will see me as a god after I die. Steve Jobs, people look at him as a god. Or Mahatma Gandhi, or let's say Nelson Mandela, or Abraham Lincoln. All these people, they are considered a step above the normal human. So I think that's what the selfish reason would be, to create a legacy that people will remember after you die, those who will cry after you die, Robin Sharma's book. And then the other one being having a sense of purpose or duty towards the people, that is the humanity. What can I contribute? That's my take on that.
That's very interesting. And that's actually a very interesting take on it. And what you said is, all the people that you named, they have become legends, not because of what they did, but of how they lived their lives. I think that's something that we fail to recognize. Now, if I ask you, what are the things that Mahatma Gandhi did? There's a long list. But what stands out and what he's celebrated for is how he lived his life. Like how he went to UK and he took a goat with him and he tied it in front of Westminster so that he could get the milk from that. That's defining him. And that's, he did it with a purpose. He did it with the purpose to tell the British that I'm going to do the way I want to do things, not the way you want me to do things. So Nelson Mandela, again, he spent 25, 26 years in jail, right? It's the question of, he came back out of jail, he got released, and how he led his country to freedom from apartheid. Same with Abraham Lincoln. If he asks you, what did they do? The chances of us remembering what they did is going to be very low. But the chances of us remembering how they lived their life is going to be very high. I think that's the point I'm trying to make. And you talked about, you know, by the time you die, you want to leave a legacy. That's quite interesting, actually. So I think I'm going to tell a story to answer Aditya's question. Okay, this is a fiction, obviously. This is a story from ancient times, very ancient times, in Eastern philosophy. So Eastern philosophy is like India and the Far East. So to be just clear, this is a story of someone who made a lot of money. This is a story of someone who had a lot of degrees and studies, you know, all that sort of thing. This is a story of someone who had a lot of followers and friends. So this chap, he was lying on his deathbed. He was old. And like someone said, you know, sometimes you have to die, you have to keep a legacy. So he was about to die and he knew that he was going to die. So here are the story. There's metaphors in it. So listen to it very carefully. So as he lay on bed, he thought of his life and he thought that I cannot go into the afterlife or death alone. I need someone to go with me. Okay. So this guy had 4 wives. He loved his 4th wife the most. Young, beautiful. So he said, will you go with me after death? She said, no way. Forget it. You think I'm going to go with you? No chance. Okay. So he went to his 3rd wife, called his 3rd wife. And said, will you go? And he loved her as well. He was very proud of her. So he said, will you go with me? He said, you're crazy. No way I'm going with you. So the 4th wife had said, I'm very young and I'll remarry and I'll, you know. The 3rd wife said, forget it. You're crazy. How can I go with you? Went to his 2nd wife. 2nd wife was a bit older, of course. The 2nd wife said, unfortunately, I can't go with you after death. But I'll go with you till the cremation ground. I'll give you company till there. But after that, I cannot go. So by this time, this chap was like, you know, so what the hell? Yeah? I did all of these things and none of them want to come with me. Then suddenly his 1st wife, who was almost as old as he is, said, I'll come with you. Now this wife is old. He had never taken care of her. He had always neglected her. And she's saying that I'll come with you. He was surprised. The moral of the story is the 4th wife is all the money the guy had accumulated, which is useless when the guy is on the deathbed. So he cannot take the money with him anywhere. So the 4th wife signifies the wealth a person has created, which is totally useless, end of death. The 3rd wife is all the degrees and studies and, you know, all the recognition that he got as a scholar, which is again something he cannot take with him in after death. He has to leave it behind. It might have made him proud, it might have made him, you know, all that sort of things, but it's really worthless when he's on the deathbed. The 2nd wife are his friends and family who are going to be with him all the time till the cremation ground. They cannot go beyond. But they do love him as well, so they can go up to there. The first wife who said, I'll go with you after death, is his soul. Is his soul. And he has always neglected to look after his soul. So the soul is battered, poor, ugly, and that's the one that will go with him afterlife. So basically what this story tells us is, yes, we need to go after money, we need to go after recognition, we will have friends and family, but the most important thing that we need to spend time on is developing ourselves. There's a question I'm going to ask the two of you is, where do you live? Simple. Where do you live? Aditya is laughing. So where do you live, Aditya?
I'm pretty sure this has a catch in it. So I'm trying to think of it in a different perspective. But till now, I don't have a very imaginative answer. So I'll just go ahead with the most obvious one. I live in Dilshad Garden, Delhi. But I know this is not the right answer. Mr. Sen is asking some. He has a catch in it.
Samant, where do you live?
Me? I'm trying to come up with a...
try saying the earth.
No, I think... Okay, here's this could probably... I'm kind of ripping off a person's answer, a famous, but I'm modifying the answer to suit your question. Where do I live? In the memories of the people that love me.
Okay, that's a nice answer. Both of you gave nice answers. Now, now Aditya, I want to ask you a question. So you live in Dilshad Nagar, Delhi. Do you take care of where you live?
Exactly where I live, probably not. But in my country, a bit, yes.
So you don't take care of your home, where you sleep and all that?
I'm not sure I do that a lot. Like I don't think I can claim credit for that. Most of that my mom does. Like, you know, so she
someone
do
does. Almost, someone
yeah.
does.
Yeah.
So basically someone is taking care of the house where you live. Keeping it nice, clean, neat, dusting it, cleaning it, all that sort of things, right?
Right.
Okay. Samant? Who's taking care of the place where you live? You're muted.
Oh, so sorry. when you say where I live, obviously within my room, the four walls that I live in, I take care of everything by myself.
So he's changed his answer. Okay, good.
you
take care of it. Fine, can continue.
But outside my room, that is like even the stairs that I walk upon. The building I stay in, there are people that do that.
Well, I'll tell you where I live. I live in myself. That's where I live. So I live in myself, and myself consists of my physical body. It consists of my mind, consists of my emotions, and it consists of my spirit. And like both of you said, you take care of it, clean it, or someone else does. I also take care of my body, the place where I live, my mind, my emotions, and my spirit. If I don't take care of the place where I live, then I'll be living in hell. And that's what happens to all of us, because we don't take care of the place where we live in. We clutter our body with a lot of junk that goes into our bodies. We clutter our mind with even more junk by thinking and thinking extra and all that sort of things. Our emotions are totally unbalanced and we don't know what to do with it and how to react in many things. And the spirit of ourselves, we don't even think about it. Like that old man, he never thought about his soul. He forgot about it. So if we take the time and devote time to the place where we live, the rest of the balance will automatically take care of itself. That's the way I would answer Aditya's main question of work-life balance.
I want to read out a few audience comments before
you better do.
I have a topic for the final segment, the 5 to 10 minutes that we have. Before that, Aditya put up a question in the comment section. asking what is the best use of time according to you. So firstly, Anita ji commented, follow some rule of life to be on track of life, but not required to follow fixed paths. As everyone is so unique, so life should be lived uniquely. Live people, but follow your own pattern, which work for you in best. Give yourself maximum utilization of your time and fullest happiness. Of course, I'm not going to add anything to the audience comments. These are your views, and I'll let it end there. I think I won't do you any injustice. Anju ma'am ne bola hai ki samay ki dhara ko saath chalna hi buddhimani hai. And there's a comment by Weber Arora. Weber Arora, good to see you. Being mindful while doing everything and staying in the present moment is the best use of time. It requires years of practice to master this.
I quite agree with that.
Right. Let's see. And answering to what you asked, Mr. Sen, where do you live? Anita ji has firstly commented, I live on a beautiful planet. And then she went and paraphrased it to, changed it to, I live in a body.
Because Mr. Say mentioned spirit, right? My spirit is inside my body. So he went full spiritual. So Anita ji is also like, okay, I'll also go spiritual then.
Was it before I said it or after I said it?
Probably after you said it. Anita ji, let us know in the comments whether it was before or after. but one good thing is like, you know, I'll put one comment. The way Mr. Sen summarized it, you know, how we should address work-life balance is the most complete thing I've ever heard about it. So in short, if I were to summarize it in my language, it's just that take care of this thing which keeps you alive. You know, your mind, your body, where you live. So everything else will happen automatically. And I think, you know, your purpose will also be achieved, which you're working towards, if you maintain this, because this is what will help you. The two hands that you have, the two legs, the mind, every body part and every neuron that you have.
Absolutely. There is no doubt about that.
Right. So on to the final segment, I want your perspective on a particular quote or a movie dialogue. The movie being Creed, released in 2015, which is a sequel to the Rocky film series, the English movie Rocky, with Sylvester Stallone, in which Rocky Balboa, he addresses on how he beat Apollo Creed, who was number one at the time, the greatest of all time is considered in the movie universe. So Rocky Balboa says on beating Apollo Creed, I didn't beat him. Time beat him. Time beats us all. It's undefeated. So I want your perspective. Firstly, Aditya.
I am not the most creative guy. So right now, till now, at least I am not. So I'm not sure, you know, whether I could interpret it exactly the way he wanted it to be, the person who wrote the dialogue. But yes, I can think about it in this way. There was a scene in Dangal, which is the movie of Aamir Khan portraying Mahavir Singh Fogat, and his two daughters, Geeta and Babita Fogat, are being portrayed by two female actors. The scene is Geeta Fogat, you know, the girl who is playing Geeta Fogat basically comes back to her hometown, and she's teaching a technique to a girl, to a small girl in the village, which is a different technique from what her father taught her. And Aamir Khan suddenly comes onto the scene and says, Maine kya galat sikhaya? Because Geeta, the character who's playing Geeta, was saying that, you know, this is the wrong technique which you have learned here. I'll teach you the right one because I have come from the National Academy. So they were basically trying to portray how this National Academy training has made Geeta a bit arrogant and a bit, you know, proud about what she knows and how she has come up from the village to become somebody who knows a lot more than what people in her village know about. And that includes the father also. So then a full ego battle takes place. Now the father obviously, you know, is a wrestling coach from long and has taught wrestling to the girl who is now opposing him. So he's in that ego. The girl obviously is in this ego that, you know, how can my father belittle me in front of all these kids who consider me as an idol? And off they start on a wrestling match, just, you know, to kind of prove that whose technique is right. And Aamir Khan, even though, you know, in that film he's playing the famous wrestling coach, loses to his daughter. Why? Why does he lose? Is it because he is a bad wrestler? So after that, obviously, you know, a few scenes progress, and when both the sisters are in their room and discussing, like Geeta Fogat and Babita Fogat in the film, when they're discussing this thing, so the character of Babita Fogat says that wo aadmi ki technique galat nahi thi, bas wo aadmi kamzor ho gaya hai. Ab soch ke dekha jaye to wo kamzor kyu hua? Because of time. So time waits for none. आप कितने भी बड़े चैंपियन रहे हो, आप चाहे मोहम्मद अली रहे हो, मोहम्मद अली भी आफ्टर अ पॉइंट इन टाइम ऑब्वियसली एज एवरीवन एल्स डज ग्रू ओल्ड, राइट? सो आई थिंक टाइम की रिस्पेक्ट करना बहुत जरूरी है एट अ टाइम. सो लेट्स जस्ट थिंक अबाउट, यू नो, समबडी लाइक अ रॉकी बैल्बोआ और एनी रेसलर और एनी बॉक्सर और एनी एमएमए स्टार और इवन एनी स्पोर्ट्स पर्सन फॉर दैट मैटर. देयर इज अ फिक्स्ड पीरियड ऑफ व्हेन यू आर एट योर पीक. यू नो, यू कैन नॉट बी टू यंग, यू कैन नॉट बी टू ओल्ड. सो obviously, you know, different people have different peaks. Sachin Tendulkar started playing when he was 16. Misbah Ulhaq started international cricket when he was 33. It differs. But at the same time, you have to respect time because nobody has played international cricket at the age of 54. Neither has anybody played it at the age of 12. Similarly, for other sports and other careers also, there is a, you know, proper time slot. Hence, I would like to close with that, you know, there is a proper time for everything and you cannot really control that. That's not in your control. So the best you can use your time for is the, you know, is the best use of it. So it's just that time can defeat us all. It's, you know, a little bit of that is out of our control. So we should try to control what is in our hands, that is our use of that particular time which we are presently living in.
Okay.
Mr. Sen, your take on this, time beats us all, it's undefeated.
Oh, okay. Actually, what Aditya talked about is the perspective of, you know, how you look at time. So yes, so at different times in your life, you look at different things in a different way. It's fine. Now, what Creed said or did, and what Rocky sort of said, what defeated him. Now, as I told you, you need to take care of your own home where you live. It doesn't, and also I told you that how you live your life defines you, not what you have done. So my take is Creed was a champion, the best boxer, right? That was what he was. But he did not live his life as a champion. Why do I say that? Okay. As a champion, he could have led his life by being a champion and then walking away. Then he would have created that legacy, which would have stayed forever. So it's how he led his life as a champion is what defeated him. Because he was at whatever, I mean, his physical being was weaker, his mental reflexes were not that fast. Emotionally, he was also less balanced than what he was, so on and so forth. So at that point of time, he could have chosen on how he wanted to live the rest of his life. Because if he had not taken that fight, he would have been the undefeated champion, right? So it's a choice he made of how to lead his life. The problem is, when we make that choice, there's so much of pressure from different places, from peers, from people who are older to you, people who are junior to you, people who are your fans. So many pressures are there. It's a question of how you deal with that pressure. So it's a question of how you live your life. That's what matters. How you take care of the place where you live. As long as you're clear on that, you'll always be a champion. You don't have to be a Rocky or you don't have to be a Creed. You'll be a champion. You'll be Samad the champion. Yeah, that's what you'll be. You'll be Aditya the champion if you fix the way of how you want to live.
Right. I did have a few comments of my own. Like in after that, I don't think I'll do any justice if I keep ranting on about my own opinion on this particular.
Use the word rambling. Use the word rambling, not ranting.
No, for myself. Okay. Right, but I will end it on, as bahut sare quotes nikle hain, but I will end it on Mr. Sen's quote, where he says, time behaves the way you want it to.
Thank you.
With that being said, thank you so much, firstly, Aditya, Mr. Sen and Pragya, and of course the audience, Anita ji, Anju ma'am, Vaibhav, and I'm sure there are a few more. Let me see. And Rishabh, Ajay Kamble, everyone, and Shikaji, of course, regular. Thank you so much for your questions, comments, and insights. Well, there were not many questions, but there were definitely some incredible and insightful comments. So thank you for that. So guys, stay home, stay safe, wash your hands. बाहर जा सकते हो लेकिन unless it's an emergency, don't go out. Like and follow our Facebook page and turn on post notifications to get notified when we do go live. Subscribe to our YouTube page to catch our live streams on entrepreneurship. And we'll see you tomorrow at 6 p.m. with another guest. Take care now. Bye-bye.